Welcome to another COVID-19 update, and on behalf of the American Academy of Neurology in collaboration with Neurology Today, this is a really important topic. We've had a lot of fun and covered a lot of really important information, but for those in practice and really navigating times that neurologists have like never seen before, this topic is going to be super important. I'm here with Dr. Brad Klein. He's the chair of the Medical Economics and Practice Committee, but he's also in practice at Abington Neurological Associates in Pennsylvania. And Brad, thanks so much for being here. I got a lot of questions for you from how COVID-19 has changed practices. I'd love to talk to you about how telemedicine, implementation about telemedicine, like we had to change on a dime and literally within a week had to change everything we do in neurology outpatient practice. I'd love to talk to you about how to keep the practices sustainable in these challenging times, some of the new regulations that have come out, the Paycheck Protection Program. I have so many questions for you. We're going to have a lot of fun. So, Brad, thanks for being here. And I have to tell you, Abington Memorial Hospital is my favorite hospital in the United States. So thanks for working there. Pleasure. Why? Any idea why?
No bloody clue.
That's where my wife was born. So.
Oh, very nice. Okay, fair enough.
There we go. She's from not too far. She's from Warrington, Pennsylvania. So not too far.
No, hop, skip, and jump for me. That's great.
Exactly. I've been to Horsham. I've been to Warrington. I've been to lots of places in Bucks County. So.
Oh, very cool. Yeah.
So I guess we'll start. How has your practice and neurology practice in general changed in the time of COVID-19?
Yeah, it's amazing because when you think about what we were before COVID-19, we were worried about quality payment programs and this idea that we're showing Medicare that we provide quality. In reality, those questions that they were asking us, whether or not they were legitimate and valid at baseline, whether or not, we're just doing this stuff for the sake of getting the money from Medicare, it was really frustrating. And then, of course, on the cost side of the equation, demonstrating that we're saving money, even though we didn't know how to save money, nor could we have control over it. EEG was an issue. There's other things called appropriate use criteria that's supposed to be coming next year that we were worried about. And of course, the bump in E&M was great. But when we're talking about telemedicine, though, for instance, it was something that we've been leaning towards, but it was at a snail's pace. And we were really restricted from going any faster because of the regulations, the reimbursements, and the logistics of doing it and such. And of course, once COVID-19 came, as you said, we had to jump, flip on a dime and figure out where to go from there, where we had to have this social distancing, which is really physical distancing. And we had to start taking care of patients in an entirely different way. But I got to say, I'm really impressed with our community of neurologists and other providers, our nurses, even the people taking care of cleaning all the different hospital rooms that we manage through to make sure that these patients are taken care of in the hospital situation, and that everyone's jumping in to help. So the community was a major change, I think, in many respects, that we were all there for to help each other, which was spectacular. But the other thing that we do as neurologists now is not only are we trying to take care of patients in general, but we're really trying to take care of patients in a way that keeps them out of the emergency rooms and the urgent cares and the hospitals. So that way the providers in the hospital can take care of the patients who are most in need and sick. But all that said and done, we still have to be in a situation where we're in the black and not in the red in order to keep our doors open. And so in that context, we need to move into this new phase of medicine, doing telemedicine, so that way we can see these patients per se and take care of them in a way that will still work for their needs, as well as make sure that the system can keep going, frankly. So when we're thinking about telemedicine management, the process of this, I mean, frankly, in my practice, we have 10 physicians and 2 advanced practice providers. We had really very limited telemedicine experience coming into this. For our hospital situation, we did take care of acute strokes by telemedicine. Okay. So we had that capability through our hospital, but not internally to our practice. And only a couple of weeks prior to COVID, we actually had a strategic meeting and said, okay, we should start doing telemedicine, but we had no idea how. And we've rapidly been learning how to do this in a way that I think is working well for our patient populations. And so you really, when you're looking at telemedicine and the operations and logistics of converting over, you really want to think about the patient flow, just like you did before telemedicine. But also you've got to keep in mind the billing aspects and still the regulatory aspects. And of course, you know, I don't have much hair to tear out any longer, but it's been an interesting experience seeing that we've had these regulations and then slowly those regulations been taken away from us in the context where we can do a lot more, which is spectacular, but it's been a stepwise process and not every payer does it the same way. So from the process of implementing telemedicine and you're thinking about the patients, you know, there's a lot of different steps associated with it. And of course that needs staff. And that's a really important detail because, you know, we have had a significant drop in our patients coming into the office or by telemedicine now. I think it's because it's a shock to the system for everybody and everyone's still trying to figure out what's going on and what to do. But the process of reimbursements have dropped consequently and our staff don't have as much to do. So long story short, we, you know, after grappling with this for a while, we actually did have to furlough some of our staff, providing them benefits, providing them additional salary to buffer them through this time period. But needless to say, we had to do that. But what we tried to do is figure out with respect to the patient flow, how many of those staff could we keep? So we're still running efficiently, but the same token, we're maximizing the staff that we have. And we actually had to convert a lot of our staff that had really no IT knowledge to becoming IT specialists. Because in the context of doing telemedicine, you know, the patient now needs to find our phone number online. So we have our website that's been updated accordingly to say that we're still offering services. We have new forms online for consents and explanation of telemedicine management. You still have to have a staff person there to schedule the appointments. But now that staff person takes on more roles. They're involved in vetting the insurance, whether or not the patient has insurance that you accept already. But even if they have insurance that you accept, the question now becomes whether or not that insurance allows you to do telemedicine as a covered service. So if it's not a covered service, now you have to start discussing the idea of charging the patient for the visit. And so every practice now needs to figure out, well, what kind of price point do you put for the follow-ups and news in this kind of context, recognizing that you need to keep your doors open. But the same token, you've got to recognize the challenges that patients across the country or across the globe are having now, and you want to try and create the right price point for what is now an uncovered service by specific insurance carriers. So
have you done much with, so telemedicine has been, you know, tremendous, but, you know, we're losing, you know, not all patients may be able to do telemedicine. I would say 70% or so of our patients have been able to do it. We use an electronic medical record, Epic. They have to download, sign up on the portal. There's a couple of steps exactly like our staff is now all IT specialists. I couldn't agree with you more. What about, you know, telephone visits and billing for telephone time? Have you guys done much with that or are you trying to really stick with the telemedicine visits because of reimbursement? What's been your practice strategy there?
Yeah, so we try and do video, audio, synchronous telemedicine wherever we can, you know, and if the patient has family members that might have an Android phone, an iPhone, some sort of smartphone, there are many different vendors available in the market that if you can get on the internet and you have some sort of video interface capability with your smartphone or your laptop, for instance, you could convert over. And so one of the things that we try to do is we have our new IT staff, you know, coordinate with the patient or their patient's family members that might have access to try and convert it to a video audio meeting if possible. But you're right, there's still some people that can't do it that way for X, you know, number of reasons. And so in that case, of course, you know, you've got to offer the audio telephone conversation, you know, and we try to figure out which insurance carriers are paying for it to cover the costs. And the nice thing is, you know, particularly Medicare, for instance, is now paying for those services. And so even though it's not a significant amount of income, it is still something. And one of the things that changed as over the regulations is that it used to be if you did something telemedicine, you'd have to charge the patient a copay or whatnot. In the context of the new regulations, you no longer have to charge a patient for that $2 copay for that telephone encounter that you just accomplished. So it's no longer cost prohibitive for you to charge the patient / insurance care, but you can now go forward and charge Medicare, for instance, for the time spent on that phone call to at least generate some income back in the context of taking care of the patient.
Right. Right. That's great. In your practice, and I'm sure this is going to be, there's going to be regional differences, there's going to be practice individual differences, but in your practice, what percentage of appointments are full in terms of the available time of the practitioner? Are you able to fill 50% of the slots, 60, 70%? What do you think practitioners can expect if they haven't already converted over?
Yeah, in the immediate dip after this event occurred, when, you know, we declared a pandemic and everyone said stop seeing each other, we dipped by about 60%. Now we're about 50 to 40% reduction at this point. And I'm expecting, again, once the shock kind of gets over for everybody, you know, people need to continue living, getting care that they need, that escalation will start bumping up again. It's just a matter of time, because people still need help with their seizures, their Parkinson's, their headaches.
Gotcha. So, and you know, I guess I'm trying to reconcile in terms of like the impact on the practice, the financial impact. And then I'd love to talk to you about some of these new programs that are out there that practitioners can take advantage of, you know, to get us some support that we really deserve. Because just like you said, we're keeping people out of the emergency rooms. We're offering a service that is better for everyone, but we need to hopefully get some, you know, help because of that. If 50% of your schedule is full, of that 50%, in terms of reimbursements because of the you know, limitations, what percentage are you getting reimbursed compared to your usual? Are you getting a 20% dip in what you normally would have gotten, less, more? What do you estimate?
Yeah, so I mean, and I'll caveat that, you know, it really depends on the geography that you live in and the insurance carriers that you work with and your payer mix. So in our particular world, which is pretty standard in terms of the Medicare payer mix, is about 30% plus or minus. Mm-hmm. So in that context, 30% of our practice is getting full reimbursement for services rendered. Yeah. So we know that much already. And then our second largest payer has just converted from only allowing up to E&M level 3 reimbursement, right, now to a level 5 reimbursement. So right, in that context, our second largest payer is now covering costs. So we're over 50% of full reimbursement now. Wow. But the other carriers are still catching up. And that remains a challenge. So in that context, whether or not it becomes an uncovered service and you're charging out of pocket, that becomes the challenge.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, this is helpful. And, you know, from your perspective, it's kind of like watching the stock market. You never know, going to know when is the dip, when you're supposed to buy, when is it going to go back up again? How long is your practice kind of bracing for this sort of a change? Are you thinking this is another month, 2 months? This, again, regional differences, but in terms of the furloughing of employees, what are you thinking and how are you guys planning?
Yeah, great question. And always, whenever you hear the word great question, you know, it's hard to answer the question, you know, accurately and well. So our hope is, as our president had communicated, that people will start being able to decrease the physical distancing come maybe May 1. So we're hoping to start providing in-person services again about that time period, which will start, you know, reinvigorating what we do for EMG, you know, EEG. If there's urgent ones, we do it anyway. In urgent care visits, we do it anyway. But in general, to reinvigorate those areas and infusion services that were potentially something we could slow down on, and Botox and things of that sort. So that is our hope currently. But of course, it really depends on when we get to that apex of this curve of COVID. You know, being in the Philadelphia market versus the New York market, it's certainly different. I imagine, you know, other states have different perspectives on that as to when it's best. But in terms of our staff management, you know, one of the things that has come out by the federal government is the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act, the CARES Act, which was just signed off March 26. And it's really interesting because within that that package of options, I think it was $2 trillion in total, I believe there's $350 billion dedicated to this one program called the Paycheck Protection Program, whereby that'll allow a practice to actually get reimbursed for 8 weeks of payroll benefits, mortgage interest, rent, utilities. Oh. And it's completely, if you do everything you're supposed to do, a forgiven loan. So the government could give you tens, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars, depending on the size of your practice, to cover costs. But the catch is, one of the catches, is that you need to bring your employees back from furlough, and they have to, the number of employees in terms of FTEs have to match what it was in prior months. So there's some additional stipulations associated with it, But if you can accomplish this, then you can do justice, not just for your practice and its survival, frankly, but the employees who've been really financially constrained as well.
Well, so this is called the Paycheck Protection Program.
Correct. Okay.
And from my understanding, as long as you're a small business less than 500 employees, which is basically going to be every practice out there that we're talking to and that are listening, we can apply for this money, and it's literally like free money to keep the economy and to keep our small businesses, our practices going.
That's correct. And again, as long as you fulfill the various criteria, if you deviate from the criteria, there are consequences. It becomes a true loan. You have to pay interest on it, et cetera. But, you know, in this context, this is not even considered at this point in the federal government, based off of the number of CPAs I've spoken to about this. Okay. What's fascinating is that they'll give you this money and they won't charge you income tax on it if you keep it as well. So it's a double win. In that context. And again, this money is going to be utilized for your expenses. So you can deduct it from your gross revenues. So it's really a win-win. Now, what the states might do is variable, because the states are very hungry. So they could see this as income tax. Yeah. But at the federal level right now, that's not the case.
That's great. So you said $250 million.
I believe that was the number.
Okay. And I'm sure, and this may change because there may be more stimulus packages, who knows. This is going to save a lot of people.
Yeah.
That's great. And in terms of, I guess the application process is basically open now.
So the catch is that the application process actually opens tomorrow, and forgive me, don't call me on the 250, even though we're being recorded, but okay. That's about what I think it is. Cool. So the application process is available come tomorrow on Friday.
So we're recording this on April 2nd. So April 3rd application process will be open. Okay, great.
And then once people are made aware of this, I strongly encourage everyone to go to their local bank or wherever they, you know, provide their small business relationships with, and ask them about this, because they need to go through their banker to figure out this loan. And the banks are very interested in doing this because they're getting a very nice commission. So they're very happy to help the process along. But the catch is, we're also competing against every company across the country that's a small business, not just healthcare.
Yeah.
Everybody. So it's important to get the application as soon as possible.
As soon as possible. Okay. So I am going to try to get this video posted as soon as possible. So we'll get on that as soon as we're done chatting. Okay. So that was very, very, very helpful. Very informative. I need to call my brother after this. He's a private practitioner with a couple of other practitioners in Florida. So I'm going to call him as soon as we're done. We're trying, I guess, to do our best in a difficult situation. The other aspect, there's an accelerated and advanced payments program through Medicare that I had heard about. And I think I kind of understand it. It's basically like, if you have patients that are scheduled in the future, you can ask for advanced payments for Medicare. And as long as you end up seeing those patients, you keep the money. Otherwise, I guess there's something. Could you just clarify that? Is that understanding correct?
Sure. So if in case you're in a financially constrained situation, which most of us are, if not all of us, there are several different opportunities in addition available to any provider. And that includes this particular program. I believe it was released March 28th. And the bottom line with this is that if you feel you're financially constrained, you can reach out to Medicare and request the income that you would have gotten over the next couple months to be received early to help buffer you financially. And then recognizing, though, that at some point, Medicare will, of course, want their money back. And the way they'll do this, one of the ways they'll do this, is by just not reimbursing you for future patient visits. Mm-hmm. So you can just collect the income up front. So it's a sort of loan, but not really, because I don't believe that there was any interest attached to it. It's just a buffer for practices. And just to add into that, for, I don't know if everyone is aware, is we had this Medicare sequestration a couple of years ago where Medicare reduced all our reimbursements by about 2%. And so as part of the regulation changes, we also got that back. So as people remodel their finances, it's a small thing, but it's nice to have that too.
That's great. This is really, really valuable information. Thank you so much. So let's conclude. I feel like I could ask you lots and lots of questions, but and maybe we'll have you back. That's an option. You know, for people that are watching, go to the American Academy of Neurology website. There's a COVID-19 page. It's actually a webinar that was done recently on telemedicine. There's tons of resources on there. You know, for people in practice, and you know, across a whole variety of aspects, learning about neurologic complications of COVID. There's a ton of information on there. Let's talk about future implications. I think our world's going to be different after this. You know, just people are just going to be different. This is a catastrophic, you know, unprecedented event. I think that this is going to change medicine. In some ways, maybe it'll, I don't know, reinvigorate doctors who may have been beaten down by a system that was kind of against us. You know, the system's against us for a long time. Doctors used to be respected, appreciated, and now oftentimes we're yelled at. Maybe that'll change. Maybe we'll be in a better place in terms of wellness and appreciation, less burnout. Maybe not. You know, I think there's gonna be a lot of psychological, psychosocial changes. But in terms of the actual nuts and bolts practice of neurology and in terms of the medical economics, what are the future implications of all of these changes? Will a lot of these changes persist? Do you think neurologists are going to be able to practice from their living rooms and it be okay? And you know, maybe our reimbursements will be 20% less, but maybe that's doable. What do you think, if you have to say a year from now, how the impact will be still felt?
It's a convoluted answer I'd have to give you. In that, you know, we have been fighting for years about getting access for our patients across the country where they might not have specialty access unless you drive several hundred miles. Patients who are in wheelchairs that can't get to the office and nursing homes, they might need to be on stretchers. So telemedicine clearly offers so many different wonderful venues as well as emergency room situations. In addition to just the challenges of this physical distancing that we're dealing with. And hopefully that will end by next year, of course, with vaccines and whatnot. But I think it's clear that we've now been able to expand our access that we couldn't have done otherwise. And so maybe we'll be able to take care of more patients in the context where the demand is so high, but the supply of us is so low. And so this might open up new gates and new doors to try and take care of these patients. And above and beyond that, we haven't even discussed the idea of these physician-to-physician consults where maybe we don't even see the patient, but we work through the other provider to give them the right information so they could take care of the patient and decrease the strain in our specialties, whereby you know, we could see additionally more patients. So there's so many different positive benefits to this. And of course, then you get into, you know, the logistics, the details, and that's where the devil is. You know, how do we manage malpractice? How do we manage global licensure? Are neurologists comfortable converting to this type of model for many patients? Not every patient, but this is a complement too. And then in terms of the billing and reimbursements, the question becomes, well, clearly we're not doing a physical examination, and a payer could make an argument, well, you're doing telemedicine from home, so you don't need all those practice expenses in the office any longer, so we're gonna reduce the facility fees that you're getting paid and such for what you do. The catch is that, as you know, we still need to see people in person too, and so we still need to pay for that brick and mortar that we have, in addition to the staff that we're required because of the QPP program and the prior authorizations that we still need to do. So there's still a lot of overhead no matter which way you look at it. And I'm hoping the payers recognize those details as we try and reconfigure the appropriate reimbursements for that. And of course, the other caveat is if you keep the reimbursements up, knowing that you have a set dollar value available from Congress or even from a commercial payer, does everything else drop because they don't want to reimburse at that total larger number? So those are the questions that we have to figure out in short order and help our payers, frankly, figure out the best, most reasonable approach for this. So do I think telemedicine is going to stay? Yes. Do I know if it's going to look like this? Probably not. Yeah. Hopefully somewhere leaning towards what we have, but it's going to change.
Yeah. And, you know, like, for example, being able to practice across state lines, you know, the HIPAA rules being, you know, lifted. I mean, this is crazy stuff. Like when the HIPAA rules were lifted, I said, oh, wow, this is serious. Now this is serious. So I hope that our medical system and our regulators and from the federal level, the states really just take a step back and say, wow, you know what? If this is how we can practice, you know, there was an emergency, we had to practice this way, but but why can't we practice this way anyway? These regulations were just strangling us. And I agree. I think we'll be able to take care of more patients, you know, lift the boundaries, and hopefully it'll lead to better patient care, which is key. Brad, thanks so much. That was a super helpful. I learned a ton. I'm going to share it with my brother, like I said. Thanks so much for all your time. And for those people watching, if you're interested in learning more, I'm getting about at least 4, 5, 6 emails a day now from people watching these videos. So somebody's watching these. If you want a topic to be covered, e-learning at aan.com, just shoot us an email. Again, e-learning at aan.com, and we'll do our best to cover that. Brad, thanks again so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, stay safe out there.